Okay, let's start over. Hello together. I'm happy that you are here now. Join our course on machine learning. We have the fifth reading today. The contents of today is a short recap and completion of logistic regression, which will be done by myself. And then Martin will take over and continue with very important strategy or concept of regularization. Okay, the setting was or is the following. We have a binary decision problem. We are working on vectors from a field, in German from a Körper, and there is a possibility to do certain things, in particular the scalar product, so that we have an inner product space. We are giving our examples here, and we want to learn a classifier. And with the simple regression, the linear regression, we were confronted with problems. If this here, let's say, is our minus class, and this is our plus class, then we can very nicely do a line here. But if we have outliers, such elements here, the regression won't work anymore. We quickly come to situations where we do adaptations which look like this, yeah, and then these elements here, these are only classified. And logistic regression addresses this. You see directly the form of the curve, our model function, which is very smooth. If it goes to infinity, plus infinity here, it's very smooth to one and it gets very smooth to zero. And even if you have outliers here or here, here you see the entire shape, the characteristic is not influenced so dramatically. We have illustrated this for you in the three dimensions. This is our feature space. Now we have, let's say, two dimensions. The feature space here is x1, here is x0. And the linear regression model would fit such a plane here. And our decision rule is this line here. And if we go now to logistic regression, you see this is very interesting, it's very smooth, yeah? And you never reach the elements at one and you never reach the elements at zero. Yeah? You are approximating this, but you never reach them. And the hyperplane that you find looks the same. That means logistic regression operates in the same class of decision boundaries, but it has another smoothing operation. What could be done with logistic regression could also be done with linear regression, namely to use so-called basis expansions, more complicated feature pre-processing things, and this will lead to boundaries like this. However, we haven't done this in linear regression because linear regression altogether is too weak to solve classification problems. But now let's look at what we are doing here. We have two classes and you see they are not too easily separated with a certain line, not in a line in this representation. Of course, with another line in a higher space, you will see this. And if we now take our sigmoid function, yeah, the sigmoid function, which is this core element here of our logistic regression. Here are the x values and the weights are plugged in. And if we now make this here more complicated, add here a polynomial of a higher degree, here you see this, the polynomial of a higher degree, then we can make more complicated boundaries. And here you see the higher order, we have x1 squared and x2 squares. But what you should observe here, not confuse this, is that we are still linear in the parameters. That means although we have these squares here, our parameters here, this is w0, w1, w2, w3 and w4, they are still linear. You see, we have no w times w or w squared. It means actually this is still a linear classifier. And if we now take in this example a w vector with minus 1, 0, 0, 1, 1, it means minus 1 here, 0, 0, 1, 1, you end up with this logistic thing, yeah. Again, nothing complicated happened. We are still in the logistic regression situation.
Sorry to interrupt, Benno, but there's a question in the chat.
Yeah, of course, please.
And the question is, would in this case a representation in polar coordinates let them separate by a line?
Yeah, could also be done. Definitely. And what I want, in fact, we do something like this. Yeah, we, if you see this quick really here, you will see, in fact, this what we see here, this x times w times x is the formula of a circle. And of course, you can also use another circle representation and use polar coordinates to do this. I haven't prepared this now. I simply here go on the circular formula. If you see this circular formula, x1 square plus x2 square is larger than 1, then you see we predict, I will change the color, we predict 1 if we are outside the circle. Yeah? In fact, here you see the circle. Yeah, the circle is the line x1 square plus x2 square is 1. And if we would now use polar coordinates as derived features, another decision boundaries would arise from this. And I am confident that we can also easily model this here. Again, see this decision planes of the classifier. If we are larger than 1 with x squared plus x2 squared, we go inside there. And if we are smaller, we are inside the circle. Of course, we could have done this in the linear case as well. And but the linear case altogether is so weak that we haven't introduced this more deeply. We have only mentioned this, as you recall, this basis expansion and combinations of nonlinear features. However, I get not tired to repeat this, we are still linear. And since this, here's another example, you can make a bigger or more complicated descriptions. You see this so-called interaction between two variables. That means you have combined terms between your original dimensions. And what you get by this interaction terms, you get a kind of new dimensions. These are, feature transformations. We are in another feature space. And if I show you these squares, you still see there is still a linear function. And since this is so important for us, we have also written this here. Yeah. This is the same structure like with linear regression. The hypothesis spaces are also the same. And namely, the hypothesis spaces are these W vectors, or let's say the scalar product of a W vector and the feature vector. That means the problems that can be decided or the effectiveness at which problems can be decided. This is identical for these two approaches. The difference comes from the better smoothing of the parameter, or let's say the better search in the hypothesis space. Okay. Martin last time showed an important view. Sorry, I have to change here the zoom. An important view, namely the so-called loss. Loss is how we measure the quality of the hypothesis that we have selected. Here is a hypothesis that we have selected. This is a line. And if you now take a certain look, namely a look here across the input space, and now try to look onto the hyperplane. I've extra linked this for you, and try to look here. And you can observe now these distances. They are here. And from these distances, we will compute the loss. It means the error, or the cost, or the missing quality of our classifier. And the 0-1 loss tells us we are in this class or not, while the squared loss tells us a bit about the distance. And you see the distance becomes larger and larger if you go down to minus infinity here. And this means also the loss here exhibits, this is not a problem here, but it's a problem here. Yeah? Although we classify on the right side, and you see, we still incur a loss for x values that are here. It's not what we want to. And if you now go to the other form of our model function, the so-called logistic function, here you see again there's this nice hyperplane. You see the 0-1 loss, which has not changed for this logistic regression, but you see now the logistic loss here is exactly what we want. If you ask on the right side here, if we classify something here, we are happy with this. We do not incur a loss, and this is what we want, and this is really strong power of logistic regression. There's also something more on logistic regression, which we don't go into details now. This is the interpretation, namely that we interpret logistic regression as probabilities. I can't read this, sorry. This is an interesting thing for us. And why this is the case, this is something we might give you more information later on. But for the moment, simply keep in mind, we can understand them as probabilities. And this is quite strong. And this is something which reflects finally in this logistic loss function. Okay, perhaps you are a bit annoyed sometimes from the mathematical notation. Let me tell something regarding this. We've tried to make it as clear as possible. We go, let's say, a kind of American style, which means we introduce formal notation whenever it is necessary, but we don't want to overstrain this. It is a kind of minimum notation. We want, of course, if we use mathematical notation, we want to be precise that you can use this. We will not over exaggerate or ask this in the examination. Of course, you should write down the things more or less correctly, but the examination will not be on mathematical proofs. However, we want open for you the reading of more complicated books or of related literature, and they use this notation and they are often quite rigorous in their description, and we want to equip you with the means to read such books. However, if you have questions with regard to the notation or with the formula, don't hesitate to ask. We will be happy to help. Okay. What was missing by now is how we find this line. Here, this is the result here, but actually we have to look where it could lie in the input space. And what was missing in logistic regression is now filled, namely the weight adaptation. And this weight adaptation algorithm is a gradient descent algorithm. It's called batch gradient descent because we see this here. Consider all examples that we have together at once. We process them in form of a batch, and this is why it's called batch gradient descent. It is called gradient descent, gradient, or in German, gradient, direction of steepest increase or decrease of the derivative, because we use a derivative, namely, we use the derivative of the loss. In this algorithm, the logistic loss. If we use a logistic loss, you will see we use an L with a sigma. Sigma, for showing you, this is a sigmoid function. Otherwise, this algorithm on the left-hand side would not be distinguishable from other gradient descent. And the derivative of the loss is this term here. And in the next reading, we will show where we derive this. It is a famous result, so-called Edelein adaptation of linear classifier, Edelein update rule, and we will introduce where it comes from. Anyway, now let's look how this algorithm works. We start by taking arbitrary weights at the beginning. What are we doing? This algorithm is exactly implementation of this setting. We have a two-class classification problems, we have examples, and we take these examples here, you see this, and our idea, our wish is to get this W. And at the beginning, we don't know anything about this, and we simply take random weights. And then we start a repetition loop, repeat until, and where we count, how often are we there? We have do a delta weight, this is our variable which we initialize with zero. Here we accumulate our weights, and then we take each example, like I showed you before. Here we take each example, and then check for each example whether it is classified correctly. And for the classification idea, for the classification proposal, we use the sigmoid function. And here you see are our random weights. And of course, in the beginning, these results are really random and not reliable. We use this difference from our true value, which we get from the training examples. And for all examples which we try, we accumulate this difference which we get here and multiply this in this form, because this is a steepest, the quickest way to go to the minimum. Why this is the case, I will explain, I mentioned already, next week. And after we have done this for all examples, the first time we then do an update of the weight vector. And if you're happy with the weight vector, this is checked here, or if we're running out of time, we will stop. And if not, we will repeat this. For those who are numerically interested, this is not a high convergence order, namely one. If you compare to Newton-Raphson or another numerical procedure, this would be convergence order two. But in our cases, with the supercomputing and also with robustness and other things, and we have time, this does not play a big role, in fact. Okay, this is now an algorithm that helps you to solve this, and with this knowledge which you got in this reading, you are able to do such things. And with these 10 lines, you do a strong learning job, stronger than many other standard learning algorithms. I will complete this logistic regression for you by bringing a kind of fact sheet, like I also presented for LMS. Perhaps you forgot this in the first reading. Logistic regression in a nutshell. The data, we have examples. And these examples are for binary classification with 0 and 1 for the two classes. The task is binary classification, I mentioned already. Our model function is a logistic model. So the processor space are linear maps. This is as before, nothing changed. As loss function, we use the logistic loss. This is the loss that is shown here. It's written in a more compact form by using these values for x and combining them here. And gives this form of the loss. We do no regularization. The objective is minimize loss. Clear, we want to do a small error. And the algorithm which operationalizes this is batch gradient descent. We also bring this fact sheet here in a nutshell for you to show how a lot of learning algorithms and supervised learning are built up. You have to decide onto a model function, a loss function, a regularization term, which is Martin will introduce now. Typically, you will minimize this, and you have an algorithm which does this minimization. And many algorithms fit into this scheme, and we have this developed for you here to better learn and compare the different algorithms that we or other people present you in machine learning. I think it's a good, through now with this material, a good time now for do a short break, Martin, I would say, perhaps 30 seconds or a minute, and you are invited to think about if you have questions. Don't hesitate to ask something. We are happy to answer this. And with this, I will say more or less goodbye for today.